This is like my first rental car blues. They like screwed up and gave me a manual 7 automatic. Busted. Right up there's my room. The pool's like down here. It's a saltwater swimming pool and it's like really cold. mountains off in the distance. It's cool. Heck yeah, this is like the real Sunshine State. Heck yeah, this is like my place.
Very popular just lately. Just looking down the pitch there, you can see the difference. It's going to be running from this side here, coming in around the wicket. So the angle is going to be in towards the stumps, whereas it's from the other side.
Got like a kitchen in here, it's pretty cool. They're playing the cricket on TV. It's pretty cool. I like have no idea what just happened. Like, huh?
This is exactly what they were looking for. Open it quite up and try and leave the ball as often as they possibly can. And, well, I've got no problems with not offering a shot. That's out. You cannot not offer a shot to a delivery angling back in like that. So close to off stumps. There's no doubt that was the luck.
What in the world? This is like sugar cane. And the one with the red head are pretty birds. Koala dude just woke up. Thank you.
Why is there a little hatch in that tree? Why is there a little hatch in that tree?
I like to look at a catch away.
Thank you.
Tiger Air. This is large man, the lane, this is for the run of the ball walk is coming along here. It's actually a nest of an orange-footed scrub fowl, which is a picture of the guy in the park here, the general show, so I don't think the colours are too accurate. It's about a soccer ball-sized bird, a bit smaller than a soccer ball, with bright orange legs, which is how it gets its name. They're orange-footed scrub fowl, as I said, they're all pretty easily named. Something you want to see in these. Also have a couple of our kingfishers sitting on the strap up here. Two blue kingfishers there. We've got the sacred kingfisher on the left and the forest kingfisher on the right. The kingfisher might notice they look a lot like kookaburras. I'll show you some kookaburras later in the wetlands work as well. That's because they're all in the same family, the kingfisher family. Rainforest canopy is mostly it's 80% canopy cover, so it does let through a lot of light. Normally when we're standing about 30 or 40 metres below on the rainforest floor, the, looking up into the canopy, it just looks mostly black. So these reds and greens and blues that they use, and the blacks and whites, just creates a sort of a refraction of light off the plumage that makes it look black. I'll point the call out to you when we hear it, because you'll more than likely hear it before we get to the end of this walk. But if you're in the rainforest, it's basically the call you're hearing will be the yellow oriole, more than likely. Parrots, see it has the bright red head out there with the green wing. As I said, the male has the brighter colours. The female was just in front of us earlier on. She had a red belly and same size and shape to actually ones just landed right next to him there, so I don't need to say any more. You can see the difference between the male and the female there. And they're not so common up in this area. They are pied imperial pigeons. The pied. Pretty common name for birds. The pied just means two colours, normally black and white. Now the magpie, black and white. So these ones are pretty important for this area. They're good seed dispersers for the rainforest. They've got a very gentle digestive system, which allows them to the seeds to pass through without being crushed. They don't have the gizzard like a lot of other birds do. We've also got our rainbow lorikeet on the end of the branch here. In the kitchen here. If you've been around the marina or just basically anywhere around town, at dusk, you hear all the birds and the trees going crazy and they're flying in and out. This is the rainbow lorikeets, mostly rainbow lorikeets that you'll see. Especially around the marina and around the parks around the front of town. This is a female whitefish parrot again, the one I spoke about at the start. We've also got another one of our kingfishers in the tree here. This is the buff-breasted paradise kingfisher. The one here with the long white tail feathers. Those tail feathers are actually the breeding plumage. And they'll get longer with maturity. These are another migratory bird that come down from the Torres Straits. And they're actually hit around at this time of year in the rainforest. They come down here and they nest in the termite mounds on the rainforest floor. Tortoise, the long-necked tortoise and the saw-shell tortoise. That's the three types. Some of them get quite large, up to about the size of a dinner plate. You also see some other fish moving around here. We've got some runter in here, which are real gold and bronze. The outer fish have how they get their name. They have a groove in the roof of their mouth, which allows them to squirt a straight jet of water. And, more identifiable question, Australia, of course, the black swans are a lot more common over there. They are found in most parts of Australia. We've just got a tunnel here, a short tunnel. On the left side of the tunnel, we've got a tank with some of our native fish in there. And on the right side, we've got, behind some glass, some white and green tree frogs. You'll see the green, these are our largest tree frogs in Australia. When you see them, you'll see how they get their name. They've got a distinct, very distinct white form lip. We've got one right on the bottom row, in the middle of the front here. Quite a big one. There should be two or three, you know, on the glass here of the tree frogs. They do have the ability to change their colour to a brown as well to camouflage. Here's a bit of a duller green at the moment. They can be a lot brighter than this. Might want to move through so that everybody can get a bit of a closer look. You might have heard about the numbers of tree frogs around the world is decreasing all the time. This is not a real good sign for us either. They're a good indicator species as to how healthy the environment is. So basically, if the frogs can't survive in this environment, we can't survive either. Unlike the canary down the mine shaft. There's a couple of theories as to what's killing the frogs. One theory that I tend to agree with is the even in on mountain cap areas where there's been pretty well zero impact from man, the frog numbers are still decreasing up there. And the theory is that with the, as you see in the area here, we've got a lot of cane fields and a lot of farming. The spraying of pesticides and other chemicals, which if sprayed at the wrong temperature, vaporizes it and can accumulate. This is the one on the bottom sitting under the log there. As the name suggests, the lungfish, they're one of the first fish to start evolving into an amphibian. They've got lungs as well as a gill. So in times of drought, they can sit in the mud and use those lungs to breathe the air instead of relying on their gills. So they're one of the most ancient fish, those ones. Pretty, just to give you an idea, if you haven't seen them, how big they are, this is the footprint of the cassowary. So you can see that it's got a really big foot for a little bird. They're actually the same family as the emu, so they...
You can get a bit of a fight if I saw one of those.
To go down the scale is quite interestingly, she's very smooth, very soft. She's not actually slimy or sticky at all. This is quite a good sized water python. Females grow about 3 metres long. So this is quite a mature animal and found called a water python, but she's found in wetlands. So if you are in the heart of wetland country, you may perhaps see one of these. The Danger River area is quite a prolific animal around there as well. And coiled up in a tuft of grass beside the water's edge is probably her favourite little posse. Perhaps running, slithering, should I say, into the water if a bit alarmed or frightened. But a very important predator, like I say, she eats the rats and the mice. The waterfowl is another thing she'll feed on. And quite unusually, she will eat eggs as well. Even magpie geese eggs, which is a pretty big...
So she doesn't bite at all, unless really she gets scared.
Oh, she can bite, but she's not poisoned. Feeling safe. She feels safe and comfortable. She does not feel the need to lash out and bite. Animals generally bite because they feel insecure or scared or frightened, right? She feels as safe as a baby. So have a pat if you like. Basically, it's just that play of light. It's refraction of light, like a rainbow. Out of the sunlight, she's pretty much a dull brown colour, which is not the best colour to be in Australia as far as brown snakes go. We're generally mess out the other end, that's
oh
right.
My God.
Yeah, about a week or 5 days and it'll come out the other end, depending on the temperature that
she
she's living in.
The whole right thing.
Mm. Her through jaw will flex open.
Yeah.
It's not fixed in
bone. Can you see it? I mean, it must be really interesting.
Very interesting.
Yeah, yeah. It's going down.
Not
gory,
but very interesting.
Well,
yeah.
And the top of the mouth has a red eye. Here's the one that you saw on here. That's the only way that you can tell the two apart is by the red or the yellow eye. But mostly the pup of the mouth, the red eye is only found in the red eye. And the 44 mouth is found in every other part of the grave. You can see now the difference between the two. They've also, you can see they've got a very powerful beak above the male there. You can see where he's chewed out the top of the beam. This was just to make room for his head and his favourite perch up there. That gives you an idea, that powerful beak used for crushing seeds and breaking off twigs and things. It's quite hard timber, that one. And you might hear there's one hiding just behind the branches in the back part here. The one on the deck in front of us here is the one with the yellow mask on its face, is the masked lapwing. You can see it has the yellow mask on its face. Also they're known as the spurwing. A lot of Australians are familiar with these birds, also called the masked plover, or spurwing plover. That's because of the sharp spurs on the front of the wings here. They've cut many a cricket game short. Someone hits the ball out near their nesting area or near their territory, which is must be pretty big for some of them. They're nowhere near the nest, but they still attack you. They use those spurs, they'll fly past and scratch you on the head and on the anywhere that they desire. He's actually waiting for his opportunity to do his thing. But as you can see, he's got the spurs out, so he is obviously a bit more modified. That's his defence. So we're just going past it. It's quite safe. Bright blue tail feathers there. And that's basically the only difference is that the colours, also the laughing kookaburra obviously has the laugh, which a lot of people are pretty familiar with, the laugh of the laughing kookaburra. If anyone wants to give us a demonstration, feel free, we can all have a good old laugh at you. But the blue-winged kookaburra doesn't have the same laugh as the laughing kookaburra. It's a bit more of a cackle than a laugh. Still a very nice call. Also, I want to say that a wallaby looking at a group in the middle here. They're not a wallaby or a kangaroo, they're a separate species altogether called the paddy melon. This is the red-legged paddy melon. They're a rainforest mini-roo, they're also called, you might have seen from the sign back through there in the boardwalk. Quite an easy way to tell the difference between the paddy melons and the wallabies is that when a wallaby is sitting at rest, it will have its tail going backwards. When a paddy melon is sitting actually resting, this one's not resting at the moment, the tail will be going forward between the legs. Wallabies won't do that. I've pointed out the cassowary's footprint back at our dump table. We've got our southern cassowary, one of our southern cassowaries just there below here. This is a large blackbird. It's holding a bit cold and freeze at the moment. Pretty large bird, they get up to about 185 centimetres tall, so mostly I'll stand at eye level with myself. The system to germinate the seeds, so very important for the rainforest. They're actually on the endangered list now. There's thought to be only about 1,500 left in the wild. So it's actually used to break foliage aside as they're running through the rainforest. It's also a good way to identify individual birds by the height and the shape and different markings on it. Actually, the main defence is you might see the two inside claws of the foot. Quite a sharp big claw there.
how they actually defend themselves is they'll jump forward and they scrape with those two claws. So good idea to stay away from these birds if you are lucky enough to see one in the wild. And they can do quite a lot of damage with those claws. Unfortunately, it's not enough defence to defend themselves against the packs of wild dogs and things that we have out there these days. And also with the feral pig population in the rainforest, they compete for a lot of food with the cassowary. This one's actually just had her 50th birthday last year, so she's just past the breeding age there. They lived to around, the oldest one on record was 60, so Freya's got a real long way to go. We do have another younger female further down the boardwalk. She's a cassowary. And if anybody has any questions at all, feel free to ask. Some of that corn, if you move down the boardwalk, you've got one hanging out there, about six. Service, so basically the only thing that'll get away with sitting on the back of the crocodile.
Yeah.
And a bit of a privilege, I suppose. And that's the cattle egret. This one just in front of us here.
The white one.
The Pacific heron is the other one here with the long white neck. You might see another one out in the trees at the back here. It's got its head tucked down into its back at the moment. This is our female darter, a darter bird. They're one of the diving birds. We can't see her head at the moment. It's got actually quite a skinny long neck with its head's a bit small for the size of its body. But a very, very sharp pointy beak. It's just sitting on a rock on the other side of the pond out here at the moment, sorry. As we come along there, we've got our Australian sacred ibis, which is on each side of the pond here. And along with the long curved black bill. Oh, we just have a pump running with circulating water through the pond.
That thing's bubbling up.
Or it could be a volcanic eruption.
Bubbles from the pond.
There's one more ivory on top of the water. It's still nesting up in the canopy here. And there's another one over near the fence out here.
Yep.
As you can see, these are in the same family as
the
cassowaries, as well as the ostriches and the dodo birds were in the same family. It's the ratite family. It's the largest actually growing, whereas the cassowary's habitat is getting smaller all the time. Palmer wallabies, P-A-M-A, Palmer. And so if anyone wanted to feed them, coming over to us now.
I've got nothing to give you.
Do you want to feed them?
Gorgeous. He's going up to you.
The bong's a bit better, eh?
Yeah.
We have plenty more as we
park
as well, so it won't be the last chance that you get. Short grey ones here with the red on the face of a robin. There's the only member of the crane family that came to Australia. They also do a quite a good mating dance where they jump straight up in the air and jump straight up and down in front of each other. Quite their wings around a lot. Of course they got our Australian pelican, which is the largest pelican in the world. That's the only two birds in the park that actually belong to the park. The rest of the birds in here are all free to fly out, as you can see. We've got those flock over the back here. All the ducks are all free to come and go, if they please. Ask you not to throw any of the roo food at them, because they're actually meat eaters, so probably eat small children for breakfast. As you can see, the larger one of the two here is the male, and the other one on the bank out further is the female. These are our estuarine crocodiles or saltwater crocodiles. I suppose they don't